Do you know Haskell, perhaps? Good if you do, because then I won't need to explain the concept of lazy evaluation. I will be writing code in C#. There is a function that receives two integers. The trouble is that the function will ignore the second argument altogether when the initial branch condition evaluates to true. That may affect the decisions of those who invoke the function. There is nothing special in this call, but observe a different one. I will start by writing a new function which runs a loop to calculate the integer result. I will then utilize it to calculate the second argument in a million iterations. The trouble here is that the puzzle function will still only return its first argument. All the CPU activity regarding the second argument was a wasted effort. Haskell wouldn't even invoke the prepare function in this example. It would evaluate values lazily only when they are required. C# cannot apply such an optimization. It must calculate all the arguments before passing them to the function. Which brings us to the question of performance. What if we knew this would happen? What if we knew that the puzzle function may occasionally ignore the second argument? Can we embed a lazy evaluation into C# code? Yes, we can. Instead of requesting a value hard and fast, the function can request a func delegate. This signature already indicates that the result might never be used. The first argument is a value, the second argument is a lazy value. The function would then invoke the delegate to obtain the actual value, but it would only do that when necessary. Therefore, it is perfectly possible that the entire function completes without invoking the delegate and, mind this, without paying the cost of its execution. We often apply this coding pattern when performance is at stake. That is the case we had in the second call, which now fails to compile. A lambda would suffice. That 1 million iterations loop would not execute when this call is made. The second major reason for using delegates is when they cause a side effect. The function you call would choose whether to call the delegate or not, therefore whether to cause the side effect or not. A potential nuance with this design is that every other call must conform to the new signature even when the value is readily available. If this really annoys you, then you can come up with an overload that constructs a lambda for you. You can then choose the right flavor as per the situation. We call functions like this one higher order functions. The naming may seem odd. It comes from the formal theory where we analyze the order of an item. A value such as an integer or a string has order 0. A common function or a method that only receives values and produces a value would have order 1. A function or a method that receives such a function or returns one would have order 2, and so on. All that theory has little impact on practical coding. We only use the term higher order function for anything that receives or returns a delegate. But now, are you ready to step up to the next level? The lambda I have passed to the call is a delegate. You wouldn't make a mistake if you imagined it as a pointer to a function like the one you would see in the C programming language. What makes delegates special is when you extract the values and then use the external variables inside the lambda. This puts lambda on another level. We call it a closure. Do you know how this works? Of course you do. You were creating closures since the first line of code you ever wrote, but nobody told you that. So far, you have seen lazy evaluation of values and how to assign a lambda to a variable of a delegate type. Now is the time to start viewing the delegate as an object. Invoking a func delegate with a pair of parentheses is syntactic sugar. In reality, that is an object that exposes the invoke instance level method. Then how are the func delegates special and what makes them a closure? And what does the closure mean in the first place? We shall come to that by creating one such closure by hand. I could make a class that exposes a tailor-made invoke method. Another variant of the puzzle function could expect an object of this class as the argument. Look at the implementation now. It is identical to the one that receives the func delegate. The implementation could invoke the prepare function in the same way as the lambda above did, but with one important difference. The lambda above, which I call a closure, is using parameters it doesn't possess. We say that a closure captures the variables. Can we capture variables in a class? Of course we can. We capture values in an object in the form of fields. Fields in an object work the same as external variables in a lambda. Any instance-level method that utilizes the object's state is indistinguishable from a closure in the form of a lambda. I told you, you've been writing closures all your life. Before you see the whole picture, we need to get back to the lambda closure. They have one more trick up their sleeve. I will ask for only two iterations and then capture these variables into a closure. A call to the puzzle function with a zero first argument would cause the lambda to run, producing the result 1. But then I will mutate the value of n and repeat the call, passing the same lambda variable. The result would be 3 this time. The lambda didn't change, but the variable it captures did. The lesson learned is that closures do not capture values. They capture entire variables. They act as if they took a reference to the variable, so when the variable's value changes, the lambda observes the new value. That appears like some dark magic performed by the compiler. It is much simpler. The compiler will generate a helper class very similar to the one I have created here. That class would bridge the caller and the lambda. Before I complete the class, let me mention my Patreon page. If you are enjoying watching the videos on my channel, then please consider joining the growing community of supporters on Patreon. This channel is free thanks to the patrons. Every registered patron also gets access to the source code from all the videos on my channel. You will find the link in the description. Now comes the final revelation about closures in C#. It goes like this. There are no N and M. There exist no such variables. What does exist is an object that represents a closure, where those two variables are its fields. When the compiler encounters variables captured in a lambda, it generates such a class for them. These fields are now the variables N and M. Since the enclosing context will require access to them, the generated class will expose its fields publicly. The lambda is already an instance-level method on this class. It will have access to the captured variables. Any assignment of the lambda to a func delegate would effectively wrap the invoke method on the closure instance. Now you see what happens when you use such a delegate. All that happens is that the instance-level method on a generated class will execute using the instance-level fields captured in the closure object. I used to modify the captured variable above. I can still do that, only this time I would modify the field on the closure object. This is what really happened in the compiled code when I set the variable n to 3. Both the caller and the closure are reading and writing the same variables as if they were shared among them. A repeated use of the lambda would produce a different output because I modified the captured variable. We are ready to wrap all this together. Declaring the two variables n and m with their initial values means to instantiate the closure class and set the object's state. The calling context can modify these variables. That effectively means it will modify a field value inside the closure object. And the lambda can read and write them too. This screen explains everything that happens when you use external variables in a lambda, which makes it a closure. It also tells an intriguing story of classes. You can view any class as a closure if you know this.